Es ist wunderbar, so viele von Ihnen im Wien-Museum zu sehen. Das wird eine Tradition, wenn immer wir mit dem IWM kooperieren. Und das macht mir eine große Freude. Mein Name ist Matti Bunzel. Ich habe die Ehre und Freude, dem Wien-Museum vorzustehen. Und ich darf Sie heute hier begrüßen zu einem wunderbaren Abend mit einer akademischen Legende. Es sind spezielle Momente, wenn man Idolen begegnen darf und ihnen zuhören darf. Und ich freue mich sehr. Eine ganz kurze Meldung in eigener Sache kann man gar nicht sagen. Ich habe mit großer Freude das hier verteilt. Es ist nämlich gerade herausgekommen, unser Programm von Mai bis August. Ich hoffe, Sie schauen sich an, was wir hier alles tun werden. Ich möchte nur auf zwei Events hinweisen, wo ich mir vorstellen könnte, dass das Publikum, das heute hier ist, vielleicht zurückkommen möchte. Beide Events in Kooperation mit der Uni Wien organisiert. Und zwar haben wir einen Vortrag mit der Agnes Heller und einen Abend mit dem Peter Singer. Also zwei philosophische Ikonen auch. Also wir haben spannende Sachen hier. Gut, das ist eigentlich alles, was ich sagen wollte. Willkommen ist, was ich sagen wollte. Und jetzt darf ich der großartigen Shalini Randeria das Wort übergeben, Direktorin des Instituts für die Wissenschaften von Menschen und mit neu operierten Augen und deshalb ohne Brille, was ich kann mich gar nicht gewöhnen. Das ist ein neuer Look. Sie kann kaum sehen. Okay, also wir müssen ganz vorsichtig sein. Soll ich dich auf die Bühne bringen? Nein, okay. Willkommen und ich wünsche uns allen einen spannenden Abend. Danke.
Good evening and a warm welcome to you first, Professor Peter Berger, and to all of you. I would like to welcome you on behalf of the IWM to the 28th Jan Patočka Memorial Lecture. These were established in 1987 at the Institute to honor the memory of the Czech intellectual Jan Patočka, who was born in 1907. Died in 1977, and he was not only probably one of Europe's most well-known philosophers, but he was also the initiator and the speaker of the civil rights movement, Carta 77. Since 1980, we have had a collection of his works at the Institute. They were smuggled out, often book by book, by his students. And people close to him, and so the Institute houses an archive of Patočka's works, which some of which are also, of course, in the Patočka archive in Prague. And since the 80s, there has been a research focus at the Institute on Patočka and his work around the archives. Central to Patočka's work was the idea of Europe, reflecting in particular about what it would mean today in an era which he called the Nach-Europäische Epoche, the post-European era. This is an idea, I think, which we still need to reflect about more than ever today. The founder of the Institute, the founder of IWM, my predecessor, Krzysztof Michalski, saw in Patočka a model of both someone who sought relentlessly after the truth, but combined it with the social responsibility of an intellectual. The Jan Patočka Memorial Series, which was started in 87, was the first inaugural lecture was held by Hans-Georg Gadamer, and we have had Sigmund Baumann, Osterhammel, Nancy Fraser, Martin Walser, also Albert Hirschman, Jacques Derrida, and Leszek Kolakowski, who have given lectures here. Since the last 3 years, we've been housing the lectures at the Vienna Museum, and I would like to thank Matti Bunzel, the director of the Wien Museum, for the cooperation with us. This morning, in the presence of Rector Engel, and with this I would like to welcome Professor Berger, this morning in the presence of Rector Engel of the University of Vienna and his friends Professor Brettschneider and Dr. Pauli, Professor Berger received the Grand Decoration of Honor in Silver for services to the Republic of Austria, awarded by the Austrian Federal President, Dr. Fischer, and he received the medal and the honor from the hands of the Austrian Vice Chancellor, Dr. Mittellehner. In a way, I'm welcoming you back home. Peter Berger was born here in Vienna in 1929. He fled at the time of the National Socialist takeover here, first to Palestine, and then from there, 1946, he immigrated to the USA, where he studied both philosophy and sociology. Since 30 years, he was the founder director of the Institute for Culture, Religion, and World Affairs, CURA, at the University of Boston. Among the many awards and honors which he has received, let me just mention one, because it has to do with the context here, and that is the Ludwig Wittgenstein Prize of the Austrian Research Society. This lecture coincides with a celebration in commemorating 50 years of the publication of The Social Construction of Reality, which he co-authored with Thomas Luckmann, who is unfortunately not here today. And the conference commemorating the publication of the book is being held at the University of Vienna, so that they are also joint hosts with us of this event, and that also is a first-time cooperation with the University of Vienna, its Institute of Sociology, and I would like to thank my colleague, Michaela Fadenhauer, who is also unfortunately unwell and unable to join us tonight. The symposium continues. We began this afternoon. It continues tomorrow. Many of the guests who are present here have come from the symposium, but there are others as well. So very briefly, just two points of welcome, one institutional and one personal. Professor Berger has been a long-term and long-time friend of the Institute of Human Sciences and of its founding director, my predecessor, Krzysztof Michalski. Beginning in 1990, he has held several conferences and projects with the Institute, an extremely productive cooperation, which resulted in three edited volumes. Some of you may know them: Transition to Capitalism, Many Globalizations and Hidden Forms of Capital. The projects also encompassed themes such as economic culture, cultural globalization, the limits of community, spiritual capital, and, intriguingly, the economics of Orthodox Christianity. The Institute also had the pleasure of organizing with Professor Berger and his center in Boston several events, both in Vienna, in Boston, around these cooperative projects, but also in Berlin, Paris, London, and Johannesburg. I'm not going to go into a long introduction of Professor Berger's writings, because I think most of you are as familiar with them as I am. I'm just going to mention three books and then end on a personal note with one of them. Apart from The Social Construction of Reality, which is being commemorated at the conference, many of you may know A Rumor of Angels, Modern Society, and the Rediscovery of the Supernatural, and of course The Sacred Canopy, Elements of a Social Theory of Religion. The book I want to just close with in a personal anecdote, however, is an invitation to sociology. And as I recounted this afternoon when I welcomed him at the university, I was a student at the University of Delhi studying psychology those days, complaining every day at home about the nonsense that I was being taught, American behaviorism, also some of Skinner, some linguistic psychology, which I couldn't make much sense of, and none of it related in any way to the life that I was experiencing as an adolescent in Delhi. And on my 18th birthday, my father made a gift as a birthday present. I got two books, Peter Berger's Invitation to Sociology and Albert Hirschman's Exit Voice and Loyalty. And little did I dream as an 18-year-old that I would have the pleasure and the privilege not only of meeting Albert Hirschman and spending a year with him at the Wissenschaftskolleg in Berlin, but that out of the blue I would receive an invitation one day from the Bertelsmann Foundation saying that Professor Berger would like me to come and attend a podium discussion that he was holding at the House of World Cultures on his project on religion, which was being carried out with the Bertelsmann Foundation in Germany. So I would like to take this occasion to thank you for actually an invitation to sociology, which led me to give up psychology, thank God, and turn to sociology instead. And let me just make two very brief points here. One, what was the dissatisfaction with psychology which made your invitation to sociology so attractive? And that was that one of the ideas which really struck a chord with me was that the study of human action is not always one of action by human design, something which I think psychologists have still not come to grasps with. And secondly, the idea that society, as if I remember you right, saying in the book, society is the wall of our imprisonment in history. But the book also cautioned us against a humorless scientism, blind and deaf to the buffoonery of the social spectacle. And if I remember the quotation correctly, you ended that paragraph by saying, if sociology does that, if it continues to be a humorless scientism, blind and deaf to the buffoonery of the social spectacle, it will acquire a foolproof methodology only to lose the world of phenomena that it originally set out to explore. The phenomena that you're going to explore for us this evening is that of religion, religion and modernity. And with that, I would like to welcome you this evening. And thank you very much for taking up our invitation. And you have the word.
Good evening. I'm very glad to be here. I didn't think I would make it. I was supposed to fly to Munich from Boston as a direct flight and spend a day in Munich with my brother-in-law, of whom I'm very fond, and come to Vienna yesterday. And I couldn't. Today's Thursday, yesterday, because most German airports are on strike. So I was rebooked via British Airways, changing planes at Heathrow. And you may be interested in this. Some of you, I hope, are interested in religion, because that's what I'm going to talk about tonight. I'm sure some of you know about the Dead Sea Scrolls in Israel, which are fragments of the Bible in some kind of archaic Hebrew that very few people can read. You should know that another scroll has been found recently in yet another cave near the Dead Sea. And it's a fragment of some part of the Bible. And it has in it a sentence which no one could quite translate, and it's a very archaic Hebrew. It said, never change planes at Heathrow. That part of the journey was a nightmare, and I, as I said, I'm glad I'm here, because I didn't quite think I would make it. Now, what am I going to talk about tonight? Let me say one other thing. Vienna right now is awash with paradigms. At the university, there is a conference, which I attended all day today, to celebrate the 50th anniversary of a book which I co-authored with Thomas Luckman called The Social Construction of Reality. As I said to my audience there, I didn't speak except a few words. Other people gave lectures. And I said, I shouldn't say anything myself here, but how often do you get a 50th anniversary celebration of a book, one of whose authors is apparently still alive and not senile? I'm not sure of anything in this world, but all the evidence suggests that I'm alive, and you have to decide at the end of the evening whether I'm senile or not. Well, that's enough by way of introduction. Let me get to the subject of my lecture. I think in the last, in fact, gives me great satisfaction, although I have reached this patriarchal age and have bad arthritic knees, which puts me in this wheelchair. My mind doesn't seem to be affected by what happened to my knees. And it pleases me greatly that in this patriarchal age, I've had some new ideas. And that's what I'm going to talk about. When I started being interested in sociology of religion, the dominant, or I should say about paradigm. So they talk about whether they call social constructivism, which was started in a way by the book published in 1966, whether this can be a paradigm for sociology in general. It's an interesting question. I have no comments on it here. I'm pleased that some people think so. I'm going to talk this evening about a different paradigm, which is more modest. Not to start a school of thought, academic sect, I think we have quite a few of those. Instead, I think I have the beginnings of a new paradigm on the relationship of modernity and religion, which I'll talk about for the next 50 minutes or so, at least that's the time I gave to Professor Randeria. If I run over, she will hit me. When I started out with sociology of religion, the reigning paradigm, which everyone believed in except myself, was taken for granted, was an a priori, was what was called secularization theory, which can be summed up very easily. In fact, most of sociology, which is written in repulsive jargons in all languages, can be put quite simply in English or German or Hungarian or whatever. What was the basic idea of the secularization paradigm? Modernity means a decline of religion. Period. That's what it meant. It wasn't crazy. It was wrong. It took me about 25 years to come to the conclusion, nothing to do with my own beliefs or lack of beliefs or religion or lack of what religion, whatever. It had to do with the way I read the empirical evidence. And I decided that the core proposition of secularization theory about the relationship of religion and modernity has been falsified. It is true almost nowhere in the world, in general. The only part of the world, it's not quite so simple, it's more complicated, the only part of the world where it has some empirical validity is Europe. Not completely, not everyone, but it's true. Not the United States, and not almost anywhere else in the world except Australia, which no one thinks about at all, which pisses off the Australians, but most of the world is as religious as it always was. It took me some time to realize this. In 1999, I edited a book which annoyed some people. I called it The Desecularization of the World, which was not a good term because desecularization doesn't apply to most of the world. It never was secular. It's true of the Soviet Union and communist countries, but most of the world, no, secularization didn't happen anywhere. Certainly didn't happen in India. It's true today, if anywhere in Europe, Eastern and Western Europe, and it's true of an international intelligentsia, which tends to be secular. Not all of them, but it tends to be secular. Why this is a very interesting book, with a British colleague who's a brilliant sociologist, Grace Davey, who's a little younger than I, very good. We wrote a book on why America is different from Europe. It's called Religious America, Secular Europe, question mark. And how can it be? Is it true and can it be explained? Well, with some reservations, we thought it was true. And we thought, why is the difference? And Grace and I came up with 8 reasons to explain the difference historically. The most important of which is, this has to do with my talk tonight, relationship of state and church. In all of Europe, Catholic, Protestant, or Orthodox, the history of religion for most of the history of those countries has been as one of an intimate relationship between the respective majority church and the state. That never happened in America, ever. The Puritans tried it in New England, the Anglicans in Virginia. It didn't work, not because they were particularly tolerant. There were too many other people. It couldn't be done. Okay. If one paradigm is abandoned, one looks for another paradigm. You need paradigms. You need some theoretical framework, or the empirical data don't make sense. For the last few years, I've been worrying about what could replace secularization theory. And I said, what we need, I think, is a theory of pluralism. What does pluralism mean? I would define it very simply. It means the coexistence in one society of different religions, moralities, and worldviews. As long as they don't kill each other, then there's nothing but tragedy. But if they live together in relative peace, some interesting things happen. Can it be described? And I think it can be. This is not gospel truth. It's a theoretical paradigm, which I think one can start. You can try to falsify it. That's how an empirical science proceeds. And I think I have the beginnings of such a paradigm by the tail. And that's my subject tonight. It took me some years to work it out. I wrote a book in English, published in the fall of 2004, called The Many Altars of Modernity. The title suggests pluralism. And it has come out in a German translation a few months ago by Campus Verlag in Germany. The German title is The Altäre der Modernität, more or less the same title. That's what I'm going to talk about tonight. So I hope you're interested in religion, because I'm not going to talk about much of else. Okay. And religion, as I tell my students, is sublimely interesting, even if you're a committed atheist or agnostic, because there's no human virtue or vice which doesn't have a religious expression. A very interesting area of study. I want to present the outline of a theory of pluralism, in the sense in which I've defined it. Einstein succeeded in putting his entire theory in one mathematical formula. I couldn't do this. I already was very bad in arithmetic when I went to elementary school in Vienna as a child. I haven't gotten any much better since then. Can't do that. Wouldn't want to do it. Martin Luther had to write 95 theses to start the Reformation, and I suppose I could formulate 95 theses about pluralism. I don't think it would create a schism in the church, but I won't inflict this on you. Instead, I will give you 6 propositions, which together give an outline of the theory, which is tentative, doesn't mean final truth. There are no final truths in science. Okay, let me start. The empirical presupposition, and that is already stated, that is the first proposition. The world is not becoming increasingly secular, although many people still believe that, from the Pope on to various people who call themselves new atheists. Actually, new atheism is the old atheism with computers, but the Pope thinks the world is secular and the church has to re-sacralize or re-evangelize the world. Well, fine, but he's wrong. Maybe in Italy it's true, in Austria I think it's true, but not in most of the world. The problem of the world, empirically speaking, is not that God is dead, as Nietzsche thought and hoped at the dawn of the 20th century. There are too many gods. And how does one handle the individual faith, if you have one, with all these other gods around? And what's also very important, how can you create a political order with some degree of civic peace with which this pluralism can be managed without violence, without general anomie, to the sociological term? If we abandon the core proposition of secularization theory, I think I've already said it, it must be replaced by pluralism theory. And while, I haven't said that yet, while I think when modernity allows it, which means the political structure of the modern state allows it, pluralism is pretty inevitable. You can try and suppress it, radical Islam, and even what not so radical perhaps, like Saudi Arabia. That's pretty radical Islam. If you use enough violence and behead enough people, you can suppress pluralism at an enormous cost, economically, socially, politically, but you can do it. But if you don't suppress it, the natural forces of modernization, which are pluralizing, will make that a dominant reality. And part of the democratic project in the world, which fortunately is not yet dead, is to create a social order in which this is politically and legally possible. It doesn't have to be exactly like France or the United States, but it requires some distance between the political order and the various religious communities and moral communities, which are even more difficult. Now, pluralism has very important effects on the individual who has or wants to have religious faith. I'll get to that in a moment. And then it has effects on the religious communities, which especially those that used to have a political monopoly in a society and suddenly find themselves on the market, where all these terrible heretics are around and can, from traditional point of view, try to decimate their sinful doctrines. And finally, it has a political effect, because if pluralism is to survive in a condition of where most people accept it as a formula for peace, it requires certain political measures, which can be described. It doesn't have to be democracy, let me say, but democracy is, I think, probably the most viable way of doing it, but I'll get to that before I'm finished. Okay, in other words, my beginning is that, well, I assume, I propose, not assume, I don't assume anything, I don't even assume that I'm here. I have enough jet lag, I'm not sure of that. I think I'm here. Okay. I propose secularization theory has been effectively falsified empirically. We don't live in a secular age, despite, I think, over 800 pages of a book by the distinguished Canadian philosopher Charles Taylor, which is called The Secular Age. It's an interesting book, by the way. Taylor is a very good philosopher. And he's written a long, interesting chapter on what he calls a secular frame, which are people who manage to frame their lives without any reference to God or supernatural. Okay, but he assumed secularization theory. And he's wrong. We don't live in a secular age. And his 800 or some pages, I don't think, demonstrate that this is true after all. Okay, that's proposition one. Not secular age, pluralist age. Very important personal, religious, and personal religion, institutional religious, and political consequences. Okay. Proposition two, and that, by the way, is the, in a way, the part of secularization theory which wasn't completely wrong. Namely, I now use the term, and Templeton Foundation was good enough to give me enough money to have three conferences of this in Boston. And I speak of two pluralisms. One is pluralism, I've just defined it, the coexistence of a plurality of religions, moral systems, and worldviews in the same society. But there's also a second pluralism, which is important, which is the interaction between religious discourses and the secular discourse without which a society could not exist. I suppose we could have this meeting on a street corner in a medieval village if that topic was possible. I couldn't have gotten here from Boston. And to have modern aviation, you have to operate with a secular discourse, strictly, even if the Pope flies in the aeroplane. If you try to fly an aeroplane by the Talmud or the Quran or Roman canon law, the plane will crash, period. So the pilot, no matter whether he's a pious Jew or a pious Catholic or a fundamentalist Muslim, when he sits in the cockpit, he has to operate exactly like a Western, European, American, whatever pilot. His mindset, his consciousness, and everything he does in the cockpit is absolutely secular. And that's not just true of modern technology. There are other areas of life, increasingly, which have a secular discourse. Not unimportant is the law. I'll give you my favorite example of this. I have to look at my notes so I don't lose anything. Okay. Two pluralisms. Okay. I recently discovered the writings of Hugo Grotius, one of the fathers of modern international law. He was a Dutch jurist in the 17th century. And his basic proposition, when you forget the name of the book, he wrote it in Latin. I don't read Latin, I read it in English. He said that the international law that he was proposing, new international law, very different from what the scholastics had to say about it in the Middle Ages, had to be formulated etsi deus non daretur, as if God did not exist. In other words, it had to be a purely secular discourse. Now, important point I discovered about Grotius, must have been an interesting man. He was not an atheist, and his proposition was methodological, not philosophical. In fact, he was a pious Protestant. He was a member of the Arminian branch of the Dutch Reformation, which rejected the Calvinist doctrine of double predestination. I call it a more humane form of Protestantism in the Netherlands and elsewhere. In fact, he was kicked out of the Netherlands by what was then the Calvinist government of the Netherlands, newly independent Netherlands, and he went to Germany, where apparently the Lutherans were some more tolerant of him, at least, and he died, I think, in Bremen. So he wasn't an atheist. But his discipline was to be operated by as if God did not exist. It was a methodological atheism. Now, Grotius had no alternative. If you look at Europe in the 17th century, it contained Catholic states, Protestant states, Lutheran, Anglican, Calvinist, Scotland, Geneva. It included Orthodox Russia. It included the Ottoman Empire, where Islam was the religion of the state. An international law that would apply to all of these countries had to have a secular discourse. They had to agree on, they couldn't mention God, because which God were they going to mention? Now, that's very interesting. And from that area, I don't think Grotius was interested in anything except international law. I don't know that much about him. But it spread to other areas of law. And I was thinking, after I read this, well, looking at the Netherlands in the 17th century, what were the main problems of the Dutch? They had two problems. One was political. They didn't want the Spaniards to return because it was a pretty bad regime at the Inquisition, and they didn't want this back. And the other problem was they didn't want the country, the Low Countries, to be flooded by the sea. So they had to build these dams and irrigation channels and whatnot. For both purposes, you needed cooperation between the Protestant and Catholic segments of the Dutch population. So secular law, not national law, not just international law, had to operate with a secular discourse, at least in certain areas, not in all areas. You would still have religious laws based on for marriage and property and things like that. But for that, for many areas, you needed a secular discourse. And that's true of other things. It's certainly true of the economy. Money has no religion. An economy based on money, capitalist economy, modern economic structure, requires a secular discourse. Otherwise, the market couldn't function. The economy couldn't function, even under socialism, without some kind of secular discourse. Okay, to pluralism. Between religions and between religion and the secular discourse, without which a modern society could not function. That's not always easy. In the United States, the federal courts are constantly kept busy by people who want to force everyone to operate by secular discourse. You don't have many atheists in the United States, I think 2% or 1.5%, but you have some determined secularists. They want total separation of church and state. And they are deeply offended if you have a Christmas creche in a public park funded by taxpayers. And they go to court. In America, everyone goes to court. Everyone sues everybody else. And the federal courts are kept busy with this. The main issue now is religious exemptions. Can you, on the grounds of religious conscience, which is guaranteed in the First Amendment to the American Constitution, can you refuse to do something that the law wants you to do? And the secularists, who are this based on the intelligentsia and sociologically speaking, organizations like the American Civil Liberties Union is a secularist organization, and they go to court, they have regiments of lawyers and good funding, and they sue the city of, I don't know, Dallas for removing the Christmas creche or things like that. And the courts are not to be trusted on this. They go this way or that way. The Supreme Court, which at the moment has a 4-4 balance between conservative and liberal judges, because Scalia died, who was the most vocal conservative, and now either the court is tied 4-4, which means that the case goes back to the earlier court, or the liberals beat the conservatives. It's five to four. Yeah, my arithmetic, I think, is right. So nothing will happen unless somebody appoints a new... Obama said he wouldn't appoint... The Congress said they would not tolerate a nomination by Obama, because they probably rightly think he will appoint a secularist. Maybe wrongly, I don't know. The guy he appointed now, tried to appoint, is not a secularist, as far as I know. Two pluralisms. Let me mention one study we did. Until I retired a few years ago, I ran a research center at Boston University, which Professor Randeria was kind enough to mention. It was called, I think it ceased to exist. It's being swallowed by some other part of the university, which is the fate of all university departments. It was or is called the Institute of Study of Religion, Culture, and World Affairs. We abbreviated as CURA. And we had a very interesting study, which also financed by an American foundation, on the hospital as a meeting place of religion and secularity, every day. Now, modern medicine, of which a hospital is the temple all over the world, operates by purely secular logic. Everything there is supposed to be scientifically based, and most of the time it is. And of course it uses technology which could not exist without the secular discipline of science, x-rays and everything else. Yet it's constantly permeated with religion. First of all, the patients are religious, some of the doctors are, so you have prayer meetings, families come. You have hospital chaplains, which even in a secular hospital, is from all major religions in the area. I recently met at, I had to go for something to Beth Israel Hospital, which originally is Jewish and still has a kind of Jewish flavor. I met a Buddhist chaplain at Beth Israel. And he said, why? I asked him, why are you coming to me? He said, well, you didn't fill out, you had to fill out a form. You don't have to fill out a religious affiliation. So if you die or are very sick, which chaplain is going to visit you? And I left it empty. And he gets, the Buddhist gets the default things. And I didn't fill it out because I didn't want some raving Baptist preacher to come and trouble me when I was needed quiet. And I had an interesting conversation, but I won't bore you with, how are you a Buddhist chaplain in a Jewish hospital? But he gave me an answer. I know what he does. I don't think I wanted his services, but anyway. But it's not just chaplaincy. Medical schools increasingly have an interest in what they call alternative methods of healing, which usually turns out to be Chinese and Indian traditional medicine, which I think with some reason they think might help in some cases. And then there are contacts with individuals. I could give you lots of examples, but religion isn't banned, certainly not in the United States, isn't banned from hospitals. But the secular discourse is not disturbed. And if the Buddhist chaplain, or for that matter, a rabbi who went there, wanted to force, for example, Jewish religious law, or Tibetan, whatever, Buddhist morality on the hospital, they would fire him. It's difficult for some conservative religious groups, evangelical Protestants, Roman Catholics, to have to adapt to that, because they have to accept somehow a secular definition of what they are doing, or the doctors wouldn't let them. Very interesting interaction. That's the second dualism between religious and secular discourses. Which proposition was that? Where am I? Proposition two. Am I going? I better go faster. Proposition three. Three, four, and five are about the three levels I talked about. The level of the individual believer, the level of religious institutions, and the level of political order, legal order. Level of the individual. What does pluralism do to individual religious faith? It relativizes it for very simple reasons. Human beings are social beings, and we are influenced by what is around us. And when you have pluralism, you have disagreements among your neighbors and friends, and even very often within your own family, on religion. So it doesn't mean people become atheist or even agnostic or reject religion. But religion changes from being a fate to being a choice. You have to decide on some level of sophistication, can be very primitive, most people are not philosophers, whether you stay with the tradition in which you were raised, which is still most people have some family religion which is inflicted on the children, where you stay with that, or especially if the law permits it, you modify it. Most interesting group, you have all these surveys in America on religion, and everyone now talks about the nuns, N-O-N-E. People who, when you ask them in a questionnaire, what's your religious affiliation, people write a nun. We know a lot about who the nuns are. They're not all atheists at all. I think more interesting are what I call the buts, B-O-T, which you get all the time. You ask somebody, where somebody tells you, I'm Catholic, but. And then comes a list of what I don't accept of what the church teaches, from the Pope on to this or that. Usually begins with contraception. But sooner or later it gets to the Pope. Well, this Pope they like, but other popes. Okay. Religion becomes a choice. It can no longer be taken for granted. Now, that means has interesting implications. If you look at the relationship of, the two pluralisms within the second pluralism, both pluralisms in the mind of an individual, it's not a question of either or, are you religion or secular. For most religious people in most of the world, it's both and. And what's closest to home, where I'm now at home for many years, the Bible Belt in the United States is very interesting. I had a visiting professorship at a Baptist university in Texas for the last few years, ended now. Too bad, because they paid extremely well. They have lots of money. Texas is the heart of the Bible Belt. Every second person you meet is a fervent Southern Baptist. And God, are they religious. No secularity there, except when they fly an aeroplane or go to the hospital. You meet people, I think, let me concretize it. You meet people who are very fervent Baptists, usually in the South. Main Protestant denomination is Baptist. They believe in magical, not magical, they would call it, spiritual healing. They go to healing services where preacher hits you on the head and you're supposed to be cured, and they believe it. Some people think there's evidence for that. I'm skeptical, but... And they, some of them believe that they can, by prayer, divert the course of a hurricane. A very famous televangelist who's somewhere in the South, North Carolina or South Carolina, a hurricane was heading toward him, where his headquarters is, and he diverted the course of the hurricane. It didn't hit him, it hit his neighbor. I don't know how this was theologically justified, but the same people who have these religious beliefs are successful, Texas, very important, petroleum engineers, computer science experts, and you name it, strictly scientific, successful. The Bible Belt overlaps with the Sun Belt, which is one of the most economically dynamic and successful regions of the United States. And there are millions of people there for whom religion and secularity is not either or, it's both and. How they manage that, I can't go into it. I think I understand it, I can describe it. Very important. I think that's enough on the individual level. I better hurry up. Proposition 4, pluralism and religious institutions. What happens is, to describe it sociologically, every religious institution, no matter what its history, becomes in fact a voluntary association, which has enormous implications on the relationship between laity and the clergy, or religious authorities, which for in most of these countries could rely on the police to force people into their sanctuaries. No longer. People have to decide to stay or join. In other words, the laity gets a power which they didn't have before. Very crucial factor in the Roman Catholic Church. And the Roman Church has more or less adapted to it rather well in recent years, at least since Vatican II. Let me go back to the Roman Catholic example, because in a way it's paradigmatic. There are almost exactly 100 years between... I'm now with Proposition 5, pluralism and religious institutions. Exactly 100 years between Vatican I and Vatican II. Vatican I was convoked by Pope Pius IX, whose most famous work is the Syllabus of Errors, which are some 80 doctrines which no Catholic should believe and which the Church absolutely condemns. The most interesting proposition, I think is the last one, 80-something, rejected the doctrine or the belief that the Roman Pontiff should in any way adjust his role to modernity, religious freedom, or something else. And the whole modern world is rejected. And that's why Pius IX called together the First Vatican Council. Second Vatican Council was convoked by John Paul the 23rd, I think. No, John the 23rd, yeah. And I think it's most, at least for non-Catholics, its most significant decree was a decree on religious freedom, which said it was now Catholic doctrine that religious freedom should not just apply to Roman Catholics, which Pius IX would have agreed on. The Church should have the right to proclaim the truth which it represents, but not these errors. Error has no rights. One might tolerate it for practical or even humanitarian reasons, The Inquisition didn't operate in the 19th century, but they have no rights. You're tolerated if you're not Catholic. Now, this Catholic doctrine that human religious freedom is grounded in the very basis of human dignity. And one must say, I'm not a Catholic, but since Vatican II, the Catholic Church has been a significant factor in liberalization and democratization in Eastern Europe, beginning in Poland, in Latin America, and not a terribly important case, but interesting one, the Philippines, which is majority Catholic. A tremendous change, which I think basically can be described sociologically, forget about the theology behind this, which is interesting, even if you're not Catholic, an arrangement with pluralism, an acceptance of pluralism, and practicing that acceptance. Very interesting. I don't want to lose any of my pearls of wisdom here. Where was I? The fourth proposition was everyone becomes a voluntary association, okay? Even the Catholic Church, which theologically still has a little difficulty with this. All these heretics who run around and claim to be represent the truth. Okay. I think I'm more or less on schedule. Part of modern discourse is having an engineer's notion of time, which proves, by the way, that Japan is the most modern country in the world. Because if you ever arrive at Narita Airport, which is like 100 miles from downtown Tokyo, there are buses. That I think they now have a rapid train. I haven't been in Japan for a while. And there are buses, and you go to the, and there are lights. They go to different parts of the city, which is huge. So you say the bus to such and such a part of Tokyo leaves at 9:15. The next one leaves at 9:17. The next one leaves at 9:20. And they generally keep the schedule. Very interesting. I don't know how they do it, but they do it. Very punctual. Modern temporality. Where was I? Voluntary association. Okay. Pluralism and the political order. Now, in order to manage pluralism, you have to find a formula of peace. I call it the formula of peace, which means some political theory, usually it's articulated theoretically in some kind of political doctrine, which makes it possible for the state. Doesn't have to be completely neutral politically, but have to be some distance between the state and the religious communities. Two interesting examples would be Russia today and the United Kingdom, which still exists until next month, I understand, until June, and it may dissolve, which I'm not for. Russia. The Putin government increasingly is in bed with the Patriarch of Moscow, with mutual gains. The Orthodox, Eastern Orthodox concept of this is sinfonia. It's a symphony between state and church. Now, they're both reading from the same hymnal. That's not a very good formula for peace, because it means that the non-Orthodox minorities in the Russian Federation, of which there are many, beginning with Uniats in the West who have allegiance to Rome, although they have Orthodox ritual, and increasingly Protestants, American missionaries who come, especially evangelical missionaries, not to speak of Muslims. Well, Muslims and Jews are accepted because they were traditionally present in Orthodox Russia. Okay. There are not that many Jews left in Russia. They don't fight it, as far as I know. Many Muslims don't like it, but that's neither here nor there. United Kingdom, at least England. England still has an established church. The Queen is head of the Church of England. Bishops of the Church of England sit in Parliament. And the Archbishop of Canterbury crowns the queen or the king, whoever it may be next time. And the church, as far as I know, doesn't get any financial support from the state, but gets various privileges which others don't quite get. Yet there is real religious freedom in Britain. You can't argue that people are in England, United Kingdom. There's less religious freedom in England than in Germany or in Austria or in the United States. It's a different formula. You still have a religious symbol at the head of the state, but there is complete freedom of religion. And the English managed to handle this very pragmatically. I'm still within my 50 minutes. Good. I'll give you an example. An interesting man, I had him lecture once, is the man by the name of Jonathan Sacks, who was chief rabbi of Great Britain until recently. He retired now. I don't know what he does. He writes a lot. He wrote a book the other day. Very interesting, intelligent man. I had a lecture of him, of his in Washington, of all places. And he said, well, he believes in the established church. He thinks it's very good that there is the Archbishop of Canterbury, who still represents the basic moral values of the United Kingdom of England, in case of the Church of England. And he doesn't mind that. He prefers that to an atheist. Not going to be a Jewish Archbishop of Canterbury. But he had a problem, and he talked about that problem, a very English story. When the Queen opens Parliament, there's a procession which is led by the Archbishop of Canterbury. And the head of the Archbishop of Canterbury was a man who carried a big cross. And then came the other people, including the rabbi, including the Protestants and whatever, Jews and Muslims. And then came the queen at the end, the most important part of the ceremony. And he said, I'm an Orthodox rabbi, and I have difficulty marching behind the cross. So he got to the office of the archbishop, and the people were thinking what to do. And they reached a very simple solution. The rabbi went first, and then came the guy with the cross, then came the archbishop, and then came everyone else, including the head of the Church of England, the Queen Elizabeth II. The French would never have come up with such a formula. And the French notion of laïcité is still not dead. It's a very different notion of political management of pluralism. There is religious freedom in France, which very much benefited Protestants and Jews, and now is benefiting Muslims, unless they blow up some more places in Paris. Very interesting. Different formulas of peace. I could go into history, but that would exceed my Japanese time limit. You need, in other words, what I'm saying, and that's my proposition 5, some degree of separation of the state from religion, which does not exclude religious freedom, but there are different formulas of this. And actually, if you look within Europe, there is religious freedom throughout Western democracies in Europe. It's a different model from England, from Germany, from the Netherlands. It's not the same. There's a sharp difference between religious freedom in the United States and religious freedom in France, and even in Germany or Great Britain. The First Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, which guarantees interesting balance between the two legally, between the free exercise of religion, which means religious freedom, and no establishment of religion. State may not enforce any religion. And the two parts of the article are often in conflict. Right now, the Obama administration, which is, it's our first black president, which is, I welcomed when millions of white voters voted Obama to be president. I'm not so happy with him since he was president. In fact, the fact that he was black, I thought was the best thing about him. His foreign policy has been a disaster. I'm sorry, I'm still on the jet lag, so I'm wandering around. The Affordable Health Act, the domestic jewel in the crown of the Obama administration, wants to force all hospitals to include contraception, abortion, and a little bit more liberal, more religious accommodation, to force contraception program on all employees operating under the Affordable Health Act. And Catholic institutions refuse to pay or refuse to do this. And the Department of Justice under Obama tries to force them. The way I put it, they want to force nuns to hand up condoms to their cooks, which it seems to me is a violation of the First Amendment. and the nuns, curiously enough, the little sisters of the poor, which are followers of Saint Teresa, went to court and lost their case. And the Supreme Court, with its new liberal majority, has ruled religious exemptions unconstitutional, which I think is an ominous sign of suppression of religious freedom. I do not for one moment share the Roman Catholic doctrine on whatever it is, moral principle and contraception. But I agree that it's a religious freedom. If an institution or an individual say, I can't do this because I'm a Catholic, the state should allow them to do it in a democracy. And one argument I've used in some discussion of this, a state, including the United States, which allows religious exemption from military service on grounds of conscience, even in times of war, should certainly allow these poor nuns to hold back the condoms, okay? Very interesting question. In America, a real political issue, and it's a political issue right now in the electoral campaign. One more thing on the fifth proposition, then I will come to an end with number six. Shmuel Eisenstadt, the late Israeli sociologist, has written a very influential article. I don't think it's, maybe it became a book, called Multiple Modernities. He wrote, and he was very interested in Japan, by the way, rightly so. He wrote a book on Japan as the first non-Western country that successfully modernized. Very interesting. He also wrote on Israel and other places. He was a very cosmopolitan guy. And he said modernity has certain features that are universal. Otherwise, it wouldn't be modernity, like aeroplanes that stay in the air. But all modernity is not the same. There are multiple modernities. Japan may have an extremely modern railway system, but the private lives of Japan are not all that modern, if by modernity one means secular Western ideas. Until very recently, it was still assumed, although the constitution, democratic constitution of Japan, which is real, it's not a fiction, men and women have the same legal rights. And yet the social assumption is a woman, if she gets married, especially if she has children, should stop working. And that's a very traditional, religiously based principle. Multiple modernities, there are also multiple secularities. And if I say that should be, that's my fifth proposition, that a formula of peace today means, there were other formulas, by the way, in terms of the West, the Peace of Westphalia ended the 30 Years' War, which devastated Central Europe, Protestants killing Catholics and vice versa. And what was the formula of peace in Westphalia? The ruler decides the religion of the state. The ruler decides to be Protestant, the Catholics are free to leave, which is a big improvement on being massacred or forcibly converted, but it's very difficult to have that formula today. Everyone is on top of everyone else. Demographic factor of pluralism. How do you separate the two? Who has to emigrate? Who's allowed to stay? It's not a very viable formula. Okay, so what I'm saying, and that's the end of my sermon on Proposition 5, when I said about some degree of separation between the state and religion does not mean that the Article 1 of the Bill of Rights of the United States should be translated into Russian and Arabic and Chinese. No, but it means at least something like the Church of England, okay? If the Moscow Patriarch did not play any role except that played by the Archbishop of Canterbury, I don't think I would worry about religious freedom in Russia. Unfortunately, his ideas, Kirill, are quite different. Finally, number six. Secular spaces, and that's in a way a necessary assumption of social psychology. Secular spaces must exist in society as well as in individual consciousness. And I think the sociology of knowledge, if applied to the sociology of religion, gives you the concepts to explain this. Not this, explain and describe it. And a very important concept is one that Alfred Schütz, phenomenological theorist in sociology, who was my teacher, also from Vienna originally, he died in 1959, very prematurely, a concept he developed is that of relevant structure. We operate, human beings have always operated, with different relevant structures. What does that mean? You even had secular discourse in the Stone Age. You went buffalo hunting, okay? The men went buffalo hunting, the women stayed in the cave and took care of the kids and cooked. Well, you can imagine a conversation between Neolithic hunters, which is the best tomahawk to use if we want to effectively kill buffaloes. That's a rough equivalent of asking, what do I have to do to fly, keep an aeroplane from crashing, okay? But back home, God knows what religious principles were followed, and magic and whatever. Every social institution, if it is to function, must have a place in the consciousness of individuals. It's a basic assumption of social psychology. So speaking of religious freedom, the First Amendment to the US Constitution, there must be a little microchip in the individual citizen's head which accepts that. And actually the American language expresses that. You have your beliefs, I have mine, okay? This is a free country. We will agree to disagree. What is that in terms of religion? It's in the head of a citizen who says this in ordinary conversation. There is a little First Amendment in there. If it weren't, the First Amendment couldn't function politically. Because people, yeah, this is right, we're Americans, we believe in religious freedom. Is this possible? Yes, because people can live with different relevant structures. If I pray, it's not the same relevant structure as if I'm a judge or a lawyer practicing a secular law course. It's not that difficult. We do it all the time. I could give you many examples, not just religion. I'll give you an example. I think it's mentioned, as I remember in my book, I mentioned it somewhere. You go to a museum and you have an intense aesthetic experience. People have that in a museum. You're really captured by a picture which draws you in there. You're in this picture, aesthetic experience, nothing to do with religion. And then you notice it's not a museum, it's a gallery, it's a picture gallery. They sell pictures. And at the bottom of that picture is a price. And suddenly it occurs to you, gee, this might be a good investment. What have you done in that moment? You have switched from an aesthetic relevance to an economic one. We do this all the time. You are attracted physically to another individual. Suddenly you're an erotic reference. Then you discover this the political views of this individual. Say, no, never. Again, you've switched relevance from an erotic to a political relevance. We do it all the time. And religion is no exception. So I guess I'm coming to the end of my sixth proposition with an example. I don't only know in Boston, which is a very pluralistic town, a student of mine discovered there are 60 centers of Buddhism, every school of Buddhism in the greater Boston area. So not only is there a Buddhist chaplain in Beth Israel Hospital, who I think regretted that I didn't put him down as my first choice, I know a Orthodox Jewish surgeon in Boston. He did cataract operation on me, not very serious matter. I can now see much better, as I'm sure you will. I had a couple of visits with him. He's a very Orthodox Jew. He wears a yarmulke, kippah, in his practice. And everyone likes him. They say, in American English, they use a Yiddish term. He's a true mensch. And it's true. I came to him. He didn't know who I was. He asked me what I do. He was interested. Most doctors you go to, I think in Europe as much as in America, They treat you as a symptom on two legs. He didn't. He treated me as a person. And he was warm, and he's an excellent surgeon. I can see very well now, reading glasses, but that's okay. And I saw him in the hospital. Well, whether he wears a yarmulke or not, you can't tell, because he had this surgical hat on. And of course, he had scrubs. So he was wearing the surgeon's uniform. Now, does he pray before his surgery? He might, well. If there is a problem in the course of surgery, he may pray for help to his God. That doesn't change anything. Well, it does change something for him. I wouldn't play it down. You can have some relevant structures that overlap. You may decide to have an affair with this other person despite his or her politics. But most of the time, we have different relevances. Okay, he may pray before, he may pray during. Let's leave this open. While he does the surgery, he must operate with the same secular discourse as a Buddhist or a Catholic or an atheist surgeon. And if he tried not to do that, if he, in the midst of a surgery problem, he looked something up in the Talmud, which apparently he knows very well, he's in a study group with other people, the surgery would fail. And his patients, even if they were other Orthodox Jews, being in America, they would sue him. So it's within the mind of the individual. And the concept of relevant structures doesn't necessarily explain it, but it describes how this is done. And this applies to petroleum engineers in Texas and to any other religious person. Let me give you one more example, which I like. I came on it very recently because I watched it on television. All of you, I'm sure, have seen pictures of the Poopmobile, that white car, which looks suspiciously like a golf cart, which the Pope uses to travel through the vast reaches of Vatican State, which is about as big as Central Park in New York. And he takes it with him, or maybe there's one waiting for him when he goes to Latin America or somewhere else. Well, let's say that something happens. The Pope's mission, as defined in Roman Catholic doctrine, has intense relationship with the supernatural. So let me assume, which the Pope has enormous authority, not just in this world, but in the next. Let's assume he's on his way to a sanctification process. Yet another Brazilian nun is being declared a saint, which means Catholics can pray to her and she can perform miracles. In fact, if she couldn't perform miracles, she could not be sanctified. She couldn't be a saint. So he's on a supernatural mission. He enters his Popemobile ready to go. The Brazilian nun is waiting in paradise. The car won't start. What does he do? Or rather, his entourage, what do they do? I'm sure that the Vatican has an office of exorcism, because exorcism is a recognized right in canon law of driving out evil spirits. They must have a telephone. What did his entourage do? Did they call the office of exorcism? No. I'm sure they have a huge garage in the Vatican. They called a technician, garage technician, so that the damn car will start. That is different relevant structures. And even the Pope, whether he's flying an airplane or whether he's driving, having been driven to a ceremony, supernatural ceremony in his Popemobile, has to operate with two different relevant structures, or at least his entourage have to do that. I've been a spiritual Japanese, I finished. I think within 50 minutes. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you, Professor Berger. It just remains for me to speak a word of deep appreciation, not only for your undertaking such an arduous journey. We did not intend to bring you through Heathrow, but fate willed it otherwise. We hope we're going to send you back home without your having to pass through Heathrow. And thank you very much for this really wide-ranging talk, disentangling so many of the vexed issues around the question of religious plurality in modern societies, both looking at the kinds of political questions and dilemmas around the management of plurality. The one aspect I was hoping you would also go into is the inner plurality within religions, which I think is also something which is increasing with modernity in the nature of and the institutional structure of religious beliefs themselves. But you decided to be Japanese in your time discipline, so I didn't remind you that there would have been a second aspect to the plurality that you were setting out to describe. But thank you very much for accepting our invitation and for the talk this evening. Thank you.